So this is, so now you're in Vegas. This is the yes. birth, the beginning of Las Vegas.
Beginning.
At the highest level.
The highest.
But now it was growing.
Enormously.
Buildings were being built, homes were being built.
5,000 families a month.
People are coming yeah. into Vegas yes. now, so there's way more work going on.
Right.
There's more hotels that are looking right. for more musicians. At what point now did you start to work, you know, to a level where you were probably working with several different people at the time?
Okay, now what happened was, I get a job with the relief band. Now, it's the best job in town because it pays twice as much. Mm. So the scale was 125, whatever, we're making 250. But we have to play a different show every night. Mm. So this went on for a couple of years. I'm playing with, you know, Lena Horne, I mean, all the stars. Every star that was in Las Vegas.
Big acts. These are the biggest entertainers.
The biggest acts. Yeah. And I'm also playing the lead of the Paris show with the Follies Bergère. But I have all of this to thank to Henry Adler because he gave me a very good
foundation. Yeah, yeah.
And I knew I was able to read everything. It didn't matter, man. And so I learned, you know, syncopation and like cutting with the brass, you know, and learning brass figures. For a long time, I studied with the trumpet player just so I could learn all the brass things, the brass figures.
Yeah.
So this went on for quite a while. I'll give you a little example. I'm playing for Danny Thomas at the Sands Hotel, at a relief band, okay? And we come in, I'm playing, and he's doing a soliloquy, a very, very like... sad, you know, soliloquy, a story, you know, that, so he goes in, and before he goes into his punchline, my drum seat breaks, and as it breaks, I fall over the drums. As I fall over the drums, the trombone section goes in front, the trumpet section
this
goes
is the
in
the domino front. Theory.
Yeah, the domino theory. So before you know it, all the instruments are on the stage. And I thought, I said, surely I'm going to get fired. This is horrible, you know. But Danny Thomas was wonderful. He said, can we keep that in the show? It was Judy Garland, you know, many, many, Ray Bolger, Red Skelton, all the...
But these are such important names as we do this for the next generation. Ray Bolger, a phenomenal dancer. I mean, he was the Scarecrow in The Wizard of Oz. I mean, these are deep, deep, legendary entertainers at the highest level.
Yes.
And Vegas seemed to be the core of where they all came here to work. And here you are playing behind all of them. What an experience and what an intensity.
It was thrilling and it was wonderful for me because it got me a chance. I had worked with house bands, but you do the same show all the time. Yeah. Now I'm doing a different show every night.
Yeah, yeah.
This was wonderful. I'm playing for Lena Horne, okay?
Yeah. Wonderful singer.
And guess who's conducting? Benny Carter, okay? You know Benny Carter.
Absolutely, okay. Benny Carter.
So Benny Carter's conducting. He said, Bobby, listen, the Moulin Rouge is opening up on the west side. It's, I got a whole black band, you know, Wardell Gray, you know.
Moulin Rouge, a whole other hotel opening up.
West side, big, big, major hotel, but only for black people.
Yeah.
But I want you to come and play. I said, would you mind that you'll be the only white guy? I said, no, it'll be my pleasure, you know. So I came there and Wardell and I were friends because we had worked on 52nd Street together for a while. Mm. So Wardell came in and he was one of the saxophones. Joe Lewis was the host. He was the greeter. He would host people. So Joe Lewis would, and it was the happening, and Sammy Davis and Harry Belafonte and all the stars would always come down. And I'm playing this Harlem Review, man. A lot of playing, you know, and like digging in, man. And he just, and Benny Carter was just, yeah, baby, you know, just very encouraging.
Yeah.
So this went on and, you know, 6 months of that, I finished the 6 months. I got my own trio, a quartet, and I was running sessions down at the Black Magic. Mm. It's on Tropicana Paradise. Yeah. There was happening sessions. Right. But in order to get all the players, the good players, we started the sessions at 2 o'clock in the morning. And we went to 10 in the morning.
After their shows,
yes,
they come down to Black
exactly. Yeah, yeah. So at that time, we had bands, Woody Herman, Benny Goodman, Harry James, you know. With Woody's band was Sir Cheloff, Herbie Stewart, Al Cohn, trumpet players, Condoli brothers, Conti and...
Conti Condoli.
Oh, my God.
The best of
Stan
the best.
Was the Stan other side. Yeah. Sorry, sorry.
That's all right.
Okay, wow. And Frank Russellino, Carl Fontana, and it was wonderful players would come down to play. And Ella Fitzgerald, Sarah Vaughan, all the best
the
singers would come in and sit in with
yeah.
us. And I'm playing, I had Joe Pass on guitar.
Yeah.
I had Joe Pass, Red Mitchell. So they would all sit in. Sam Butera came in. But meanwhile, at all this time, I'm having my little jazz group up on top of the bar at the Sahara Hotel. Louis Prima, Keely Smith come in.
Right.
You know, but they didn't come in. The guys were reading charts. They were picking out like a saxophone part and trumpet part. So it was like kind of weak. Then he came back, but he did okay. He's a wonderful entertainer. He did okay. So they come back again. This time they have Sam Butera on saxophone and Amado Rodriguez on bass, Billy McCumber on piano, who was a dear friend of mine. Him and I joined Musicians Union together. And Little Red on trombone, and Dick Johnson on drums. So Sam Butera is sitting in with us, and he said one night, he said, Bobby, Louis Prima wants to talk to you. I said, about what? He said, about coming on the group. I said, well, Sam, you know, I've got this jazz thing going. I'm kind of happy. He said, please come down and talk to him. So I came down and talked to him, and he kind of hypnotized me. You know, Bobby, we're going to do the Colgate Comedy Hour. Frank Sinatra special, the Dinah Shore, see the USA in your
Chevrolet, absolutely, yeah.
So he hypnotized me. He says, Bobby, I want you to come down. We're missing that one link. We'd like to have you. I said, well, you know what? I says, well, I don't know. I said, look, how much money are you making now? I said, well, I'm making $200 as the leader of the group. He says, I'll give you $300. I'll take it. I said, but on one condition, Louis, I got one idea. I said, I noticed your drummer is playing a shuffle with two hands. Digga, 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 digga. I said, I'd like to try something different, I feel, that would enhance it a little bit more. He said, well, why don't you and Amado, Billy, go ahead and rehearse and then come back. So we rehearsed, and I did the left-hand shuffle, ding-ga-ding-ga-ding-ga-ding-ga-ding-ga-ding-ga-ding-ga-ding, against time, ding-ding-ga-ding-ga-ding-ga-ding.
Which came out of the Chapin book.
Right, right. But however, nobody ever used it in a commercial sense.
Interesting.
And nobody ever used it at these kind of tempos.
Yeah.
Okay, now, he loved it. Louis Prima, we played it, just a gigolo, do ba do ba do, you know, and he, oh my God, he went crazy. So he says, he said, well, let's play it at this tempo, you know, when you're smiling, you know, way Marie, you know. So anyhow, it became a thing, and a lot of drummers started coming in.
That's
and
amazing.
And to play that at that tempo was, I guess, that's
still very difficult to do.
It's very, very difficult.
Yeah.
And when I practiced, we would come in and he wanted me to start playing before they even, as they're walking up on stage, ding, 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 and they're walking up on stage and I'm playing. Now we go, when you're smiling.
Then the song started, you kept on going.
Yeah. So we started recording for Capitol Records. We did the Wildest, the Call of the Wild, Wild Shore, Lake Tahoe, whatever. And Royal Gilmore started getting, he became very friendly with me. He said, man, that, you know, I would like you to do some tracks, you know, some rock and roll tracks. I said, to me, rock and roll at that time was, you know. So I like your intensity. So I said, wonderful, I'll be happy to do it. So I did about three sessions or four sessions every 2 weeks. Mm. And it paid about $350 or $425, whatever, at the time.
Yeah.
So this was wonderful. So I got to do that. And we're doing all this recordings, and we're doing all the shows, you know, the Frank Sinatra, the Colgate Comedy Hour, Dinah Shore, every special, you know. Then we start doing the Ed Sullivan shows, and and this is a story I think you might enjoy. We're working the Shea Perie in Chicago, the Moulin Rouge in Hollywood, the Latin Casino of Philadelphia.
The biggest places.
And the Copacabana in New York.
Biggest.
And at the Moulin Rouge, Peter Lawford came in with his brother-in-law. Peter Lawford was a big, big fan of Louis and Keeley. Yeah. So he came in with his brother-in-law. His brother-in-law was Senator Kennedy, John F. Kennedy. So they'd invite us over for a drink, and I said, oh, Senator Kennedy, what a pleasure it is to meet you. He says, just call me Jack. So anyhow, everywhere we worked, the Moulin Rouge, the Chez Paris, the Latin Casino, there's Jack and Peter, you know. They loved Louis and Keeley. John F. Kennedy was inaugurated president sometime later.
1960, yeah?
Yes, and we're playing the inauguration, and on the 32nd floor, I think the Sheraton, whatever hotel it is in Washington, D.C., after the show, we all got together. Everybody, you know, got together in the holding tank. All the biggest stars were like, all the biggest, Broadway, Hollywood, recording. I mean, I name them, you know. They were there. So we got together after the show on top, the 32nd floor, and I'm playing with Sarah Vaughan's trio. So here I'm playing for Sarah and Ella and Frank Sinatra and Dean Martin, the whole world, and Tony Curtis keeps bringing me drinks like vodka and orange. I'm not a drinker, Tony. Yeah, drink it; it won't hurt you. You know. Here comes John F. Kennedy and Jacqueline to thank everybody, and as he's walking around thanking everybody, he comes over to me. And I was going to say, hey, Jack, I'm really proud of you. But he's not Jack anymore. This is the president of the United States. I told him how proud I am. Thank you. And I love you, man. I absolutely love you. I wish you the best. Frank Sinatra was on the way down. We were in a bus with Milton Berle, all the stars. And he stopped the bus. He stopped the bus to start directing traffic, Dom. I mean, he was ridiculous, you know. So, we did a date, you know. Keeley called me, and she signed with Reprise Records on her own. Shelly Mann and Alvin Stoller are the drummers on staff.
Yeah.
So in order to justify them getting their pay, they have to play something. So one is playing a cabo, I don't know, maracas or, you know, a tambourine, whatever. So we open up, we fly in, and on the band is like Pete Condoli, Shorty Chirac, Frank Rossellino, Paul Smith on piano, Joe Mondragon on bass. I mean, just
top players.
Oh, wonderful, yeah, wonderful, yeah, players. Yeah. Frank Rossellino on trombone.
Yeah.
So we opened up with When You Smile in the Cheek of Araby. Okay? And I hear Jesus. Holy jeez. He was saying something I can't repeat now we're being recorded, you know.
Shelley was funny.
Yeah,
funny
so
guy.
So I thought he's putting me down, you know. I said, so when we finished, I said, something wrong, Shelley? He says, how the hell do you do that, man? Shelley, how the hell do you do? Anyhow.
What a compliment from Shelley. Shelley
but
was
I gotta
a beautiful
tell you,
player.
I got to tell you a story. Every night, Buddy Rich would come in. We're playing these up-tempo shuffles, and it's really, really hard, man, to keep that going. I mean, physically, you got to be like a real stalker, you know. Buddy Rich is playing with the Harry James Band down the street at the Flamingo. So Buddy's coming in every night, you know, and I don't go over to say hello to him. But as I'm in the Silver Slipper one night, and he's sitting with Chick Keeney, who's the drummer with Freddie Bell, who I started handling later. That's another story. I had 76 bands working.
As management, you were managing. Yeah,
agency and management. Yeah, I've got a building on Sahara, the Morris Building. Yeah. Anyhow, Buddy comes in, and he's sitting with Chick, and I go over to say hello to Chick. I said, "Hi, Chick." So Buddy grabs my hand. So what do you have to do? Win a downbeat poll before you say hello? You know, but he used the words I can't repeat. effing downbeat poll, you know, before he say hello. I said, "Well, Buddy, I hear, you know, like young drummers would come over and say, hi, I'm a drummer." And he said, "That's nice, kid, you know, whatever." And I really didn't want to take that chance. I thought you'd fluff me off. He said, "No, what do you think? I've been coming in every night." "You're a freaking animal, man." So nobody can do what you do and live, man, okay?
So you get a compliment like that from Buddy.
Yeah, yes.
But look at the experience you've had. You've had the compliments, Buddy and Gene and all these phenomenal great drummers, but all these great, great musicians that you worked with constantly. And now, you know, Vegas has changed dramatically. And then during the change, you got involved in more of the management part of managing different acts.
Yes, I got managing bands and acts. I had the largest agency in Las Vegas, Bobby Morris Agency.
Amazing.
I handled it every bit. And entertainment directors at hotels would have so much faith in me that they would just give me their open dates and I would book it.
Right.
You know, different act. But there's another little story I'd like to...
Yeah.
If I'm not... You know, take too much of your time.
Let's hear it. Come on.
Okay, I'm playing with Bobby Darin at the Eden Rock, okay, in Florida, Miami, Florida, and Frank Sinatra's next door at the Fountain Blue, and Irv Cutler is playing drums. Irv and I loved Irv, man. So I love Sinatra. I love Irv. So I go over in between our shows. I'm sitting on the stand and I'm listening to Irv and all that. I'm really enjoying myself. But time goes by, and then Jilly Rizzo comes and gets me. He said, "Bobby," now he knew me from Louie and Keeley. He says, "Bobby, you know, Irv got sick. We need you to finish the week, you know. And I know you know it. You've been here every night." Because I knew the book, you know. So anyhow, I played the last week, and Jilly Rizzo calls me. He says, "Mrs. Sinatra would like to thank you personally, you know, come upstairs." So we go upstairs, and he's there with binoculars looking at the chicky poos, you know. anyhow, he thanks me, says, "Thank you for ISIS. My pleasure, my honor, you know. God bless you. I loved it." So anyhow, Jilly gives me an envelope. I said, "What is this for?" He says, that's for doing the week." And he said, no. I said, "I don't want to get paid. Mr. Sinatra insists, okay? And when he insists, you take it."
You take it.
So anyhow, I took it. It was, when I went downstairs, there's $50, $100 bills, and it's $5,000. I assumed that's what Irv was making a week, and that was very good money in those days.
Yeah.
Anyhow, I'm working with different bands. I'm going with different bands. Eddie Fisher and Buddy Hackett were doing a tour, you know, in the United States. But the tour ends, and Eddie Fisher winds up at the Waldorf Astoria. And see, my father, I was practicing all those hours, he says, "What are you practicing all those hours? I could get you a job making the paper hanging, make $25 a week, you know." So anyhow, I'm at the Waldorf Astoria. I have a suite. It's 12 weeks, man. It was, and Power of the Pen and all the restaurants.
Yeah.
So my father and mother come down, and they have dinner, and Eddie introduces them. They stand up, the spotlight. They didn't know when to sit down. They were scared to death.
But these are the biggest names in Hollywood.
Right.
Vegas.
So, anyhow, we go down, you know, and I'm to cash my check, and I bring my father down with me, a cashier's cage, and the man is counting out $100 bills, and 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10, 11, 12, 13, 14, 15. I said, thank you very much. He says, and my father says, I says, what is that? He said, that's what I get paid a week, Pa. He said, now you robbed a bank. I said, I didn't rob a bank. You wanted me to be a paper hanger. You know, I wanted to play music.
You followed your dream. Yes. You pursued this at the highest level. But, you know, you practiced the instrument. You put time into the instrument. You researched it. You kept studying. Your practice pad probably traveled with you in the course of all the different traveling that you did. Yes. This is an amazing dedication and perseverance, Bobby, that you've done.
It was a matter of perseverance. Yes. It's very good. And attitude is very good. Attitude, and it's working very hard at your craft and having a good attitude and listening, you know, to your elders or people that you respect. There's a very quick story I'd like to tell you. I'm with Eddie Fisher in Mexico City. A man comes in, and his name is Dr. Goldberg. And so he introduced me to Dr. Goldberg. Do you know the story?
I do, but you only knew him as Dr. Goldberg.
Yes. So anyhow, I'm getting married to one of my wives. I was married a few times. So she comes out, and Eddie says, I want to be your best man. I'll give you...
So Eddie Fisher is one of your best men.
Yeah, I'll give you $1,000 as a gift, you know. So Dr. Goldberg says, oh, I want to be your best man. I'll give you $1,000 too as your best man. So we go out to Teotihuacan, Mexico, and we get married. On the way back, we come back, and there's Dr. Goldberg invites us over to his villa. So we drive up to the villa, and there's men on the top of the roof with machine guns, and he's cooking this wonderful Italian food, and I'm going crazy. Oh, the smells, you know. So I go over to Dr. Goldberg. I said, Dr. Goldberg, can I ask you something? He said, what? He says, there's men with machine guns up in the roof. He said, well, Bobby, some people don't like me. But now that I'm your best man, my name isn't Dr. Goldberg. I said, well, what is it? Sam Giancana.
Who at the time was probably the biggest, you know.
Daniel Glass. Do you know Daniel Glass?
Yes, absolutely.
Daniel wrote a book with Steve Smith, you know, and the Roots of Rock.
I'm
kind of one of the guys on the cover.
Absolutely,
first thing. So Daniel Glass, when he heard that story, he says, Bobby, I'm working my off nights at Birdland, you know. He says, could you send me that picture? You know, I've got that picture, by the way, you know, of Sam Giancana, Eddie Fisher. And the girl there was like Judith Hefner. She was... a girlfriend of Sam Giancana, but she was also formerly...
Of Jack Kennedy.
Of Jack Kennedy, yes.
Absolutely, yes. And, she wrote a book later on, too.
Yes, right.
So, you were right in the thick of it.
Right. I cannot tell you the exciting days. It's very business-like. You know, before... Years ago, the boys would run the place. I mean, hey, Bobby, have a chuck wagon, whatever, you know. He couldn't pay for anything. Because we were pretty known at that time, you know, with Louie and Keeley, and so I knew everybody at the time. You know, it was a different situation there, you know.
So Vegas has changed tremendously, you know.
Yes.
But the memories and the stories and the history that you were a part of building this city, Bobby, is absolutely amazing. You know, when the young generation, when they hear these stories and all these names that you've mentioned, from Ronald Reagan to Jack Kennedy, these are incredible, powerful people that have moved the culture of America, and Sinatra and Louis Prima, all these great musicians that shifted and changed, Streisand, Lena Horne. These are the biggest of the biggest names.
One of the acts, as a matter of fact, is the Rat Pack. It was Dean Martin, Frank Sinatra, Joey Bishop,
Sammy Davis,
Peter Lofton, Sammy Davis, you know. And that was on one of our dates, you know, one of the nights.
The original movie of Ocean's 11 had the Rat Pack in there,
right?
Shot right here in Vegas, the way it was. Absolutely, that was the original movie of what it was. Bobby, this has been tremendous. You know, when the younger generation watches this and they hear all these different names, and as they do the research to see that you were a part of that history, not just being a part of it, you were at the cutting edge of making history here in this town and in the music business.
Thank you.
On behalf of the Sessions, we thank you so much, Bobby. You are an absolute treasure to the music industry, and what a great, great honor to be with you right here in Vegas.
Thank you.
Thank you so much,
Bobby. My pleasure, man. My pleasure.